The King Jeongjo Cradle to Grave Tour starts over there in Changgyeonggung, his birthplace. It's the third or fourth most popular of Seoul's five Joseon Dynasty palaces, but it was number one for decades.
I like this palace because it's a relatively quiet oasis of green. I love this palace because it tells so much about modern Korea.
To see what I mean, you have to know how its structures and surrounding narratives have been torn down and built up and torn down and built up. That story started just before Imperial Japan annexed Korea in 1910. It took off during the military dictatorships, and civilian governments are still tweaking it today. To me, the most enduring impression was left by a young girl trapped inside those walls with her child husband's spiraling descent into madness.
On those palace grounds, she lived and wrote the only autobiography that made me cry.
The memoirs of Lady Kaegyeong, masterfully translated and annotated by the late great Jahyun Kim Habush.
The way tourism promoters have portrayed Joseon royals, especially Lady Kaegyeong's husband and their son, King Jeongjo, is a big part of this tour. So if you don't know Goryeo, Joseon, Sado, Jeongjo, here's all the background you need. If you're familiar with those and the Pakchung-hee era, just skip ahead about a minute.
The Buddhist Goryeo dynasty ruled Korea from about 918. The Confucian-based Joseon dynasty replaced it in 1392. Joseon's greatest king was Sejong, but King Jeongjo is definitely in the running for second. Both are known for collecting and disseminating knowledge to improve the lives of their people. Jeongjo's father, Crown Prince Sado, was killed by his father, King Yongjo. After Jeongjo died in 1800, the court pushed for isolation. Meanwhile, about 70 years later, Japan abandoned its own isolationist policy to pursue rapid industrialization and militarization. Following the Russo-Japanese War, Western powers allowed Japan to make Joseon a protectorate in 1905 and annex it in 1910. By the end of World War II, the Joseon Kingdom and Empire of Korea were completely dead. The Republic of Korea was born. The Americans backed South Korea and its leader Syngman Rhee. The Soviet Union backed North Korea and Kim Il-sung. 7 years after the 1950-53 Korean War, Rhee's government was overthrown by a democratic revolution that itself fell to a military coup in 1961. General-turned-president Park Chung-hee ruled South Korea until his assassination in 1979. Democratic opposition leader Kim Il-sung became president in 1993, ushering in the civilian period.
Yeah, welcome back. Before we enter the palace, I want to show you a key place just over there behind Seoul National University Hospital. For a long time, this small gate stood abandoned in an empty field. It's what's left of Gyeongmyo, a shrine to a crown prince now known as Sado. It's slowly being restored. Lady Kaegyeong was betrothed to Sado when they were both 9 years old. She entered his palace around 1744 and left on very few occasions until her death at age 80.
Many girls dream of becoming a princess. She wrote that the day news came that she had been selected, she saw her parents cry for the first time. They weren't tears of joy.
She'd lived to see her young husband Sado beat a consort to death and bring the severed head of a eunuch into her chambers, then Sado killed by order of his father, King Yongjo, then her uncle killed by order of her son, King Jeongjo. Jeongjo himself died mysteriously at age 45, and then her brother killed by order of her grandson, King Sunjo. Now we're ready to go and see inside the palace. During Joseon, this palace housed abdicated kings, dowager queens, and crown princes. Basically, anyone a ruler would want close, but not too close to the throne. These high walls shut out anybody who didn't have a direct connection to the royal family, and the stature of the structure and those within it was unquestioned. In 1909, Japanese administrators convinced Korea's second and last emperor to turn the palace into a park and open it to the public. This part of the palace hasn't changed much since it was rebuilt in 1616. Before it was turned into a park in 1909, 80% of its structures were torn down.
Among the largest buildings removed was Jagyeongjong, the private residence that King Jeongjo had built for his mother, Lady Haegyeong.
If you read this sign, you'll know that the Japanese turned this part of the palace into a zoo and that it was reclaimed in the 1980s. Few people know that Imperial Japan also built a museum here. It stood on the highest point of the grounds, about where those trees are back there.
That knowledge has been effectively cropped from public consciousness. Apart from its name, the Prince Yi Museum, Japanese administrators made little connection between Joseon rulers and the new park, Changgyeonggung.
When they did mention Joseon, it was rarely flattering.
One old imperial postcard appears to show Korea's then abdicated Emperor Gojong walking toward the new museum in 1915. He's outlined in blue at the bottom. The lyrical poem in red reads, "In the twilight of his kingdom, the king walks with four or five servants, looking downward."
The museum sat on the same site where Lady Haegyeong completed her memoirs. Her father advised her to reuse the paper that they wrote to each other on. Long in and out of favor as a key official, he was well aware of court intrigue and didn't want there to be any trace of their communication. Centuries ago, when people would reuse paper, the remnants of the previous writing could be seen.
Those traces are called palimpsest. The art of palimpsest is how Professor Honggi Yoon describes the act of victors riding over the landscape of the recently defeated with their own expressions of opulence. That perfectly describes the way the Prince Yi Museum lorded over the old palace halls with its mix of modern and Japanese elements. Notice that outcrop at the base of the stairs. It's always been there. The only signs around warn that it's slippery when wet. But in the early 90s, Korean guidebooks and friends said these grounds dated back to Goryeo. And the indentations that are now filled with water allegedly marked where posts from a 9th century Goryeo summer palace once rested. In fact, that was the reason given for Changgyeonggung facing east like Goryeo palaces, instead of south like Joseon's. But Goryeo is out and Joseon is in. The brochure says Joseon rulers founded the palace in the 15th century, and the main gate faces east because of the natural lay of the land. Some guidebooks say it had to face east out of filial deference to the Jungmyo Shrine south of the palace.
At the top of these stairs is where Lady Haegyeong's residence and the Prince Yi Museum sat.
This sign mentions Lady Haegyeong's residence being removed in the 19th century. I believe the pieces were used to rebuild parts of Gyeongbokgung. It also says the Japanese built Changsogak, a modern royal library here. It doesn't mention the Prince Yi Museum being here from 1911 to 1937.
Before the new museum was built, Western tourists would talk about mediocre knickknacks displayed on the colonnades over there. The new museum would come to house a lot more impressive pieces,
with a heavy emphasis on Goryeo celadon. In fact, a lot of its collection can still be found in the National Museum in Icheon-dong. Two pieces are even among the highlights recommended in the National Museum's brochure.
That's another reason for the King Jeongjo cradle-to-grave tour. He and Changgyeonggung have had such a lasting impact on Seoul and Suwon.
It's easy to see why Jeongjo built his mother's private residence here once he became king in 1776. In addition to the great view, she could see Sado's recently completed shrine just over there, where those SNU hospital buildings are now.
She wrote at least four memoirs here, each more and more bold, as she had less and less to lose.
Harvard professor David McMahon wrote that Lady Haegyeong's life would have taxed the imagination of a Poe, the narrative capacities of a Gibbon, or an Eliot, George, the tragic sense of Shakespeare.
Sadly, Lady Haegyeong never got to serve as queen. She was sent out of the palace the day Sado's fate was sealed, and their son was adopted by his late brother. To her, all of this, especially the macabre murder of her husband, seemed unbearably cruel. But Kim Ha-bush explained, had Lady Haegyeong and their son been tied to Sado, they would have been subject to collective punishment. North Korea still punishes entire families for the crimes of one person. A few days after Sado's death, when it was safe, King Jeongjo summoned Lady Haegyeong and the new crown prince back to the palace. I want to keep each video to around 10 minutes, so that's the end of part one. I hope you'll click further and see where this leads.